Good morning. Welcome to worship at Blacksburg Presbyterian Church. I am so glad you are here today. This is a community where all are welcome, no matter your age or ethnicity, your economic situation or marital status, your disability or difference, your gender or sexual orientation. No matter what, you are welcome here. You belong. Sarah Wines has some notes about our life together.
Good morning. I'd like to invite you, as usual, to find your friendship pads at the ends of the pews and put your name on them and pass them down, and we'll know who's sitting on the pews with us. Several announcements, notes about our life together. A reminder to active elders that today we're having a meeting this afternoon after worship in Fellowship Hall, and lunch will be provided. June is Pride Month. Happy Pride. We celebrate that everyone is created in God's image. And if you would like a Pride button, there will be available in the gathering space today. Take note also of the gathering for Presbyterian women that's coming this Saturday in Fellowship Hall. They will be meeting with this virtual Synod summer gathering, and we're providing donuts and coffee at 9 a.m. Everyone is invited after worship for refreshments and fellowship, I think in the gathering space, right? Yes, okay. So I hope you'll join us there. Let's now center ourselves as we prepare for worship together.
Please rise in body or in spirit as we call ourselves to worship. Grace and peace be to you.
Be to you.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We'll begin our worship by singing a reminder of Christ's invitation from hymn 183. The words are in your bulletin.
Thank you.
Come, friends, let us find our home in God's grace. Confession is not about wallowing in guilt and regret. It is not about feeling bad. It is about opening up our lives to the one who made us and loves us no matter what. It is only when we admit our wounds and needs that we can begin to be healed. Trusting that never-ending love, let us pray together. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end, nor do I really know myself, and the fact that I think I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. But I believe that the desire to please you does, in fact, please you. And I hope that I have that desire in all I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Therefore, I will trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Amen. Repeat after me. I am a child of God. Holy and beloved. This is our fundamental identity. We're good there. This is our fundamental identity. God gave it to us. We can never lose it. Okay, wait. So hear and trust the good news. Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and we are free to begin again. Amen. Let's stand and sing our praise from hymn 582. As forgiven people, we are set at peace with ourselves, with each other, with God, so we can greet one another with joy and a sign of peace. As we do so, I invite children to come forward. The peace of Christ be with you. Good morning. Let's try that again. You're allowed to be loud in church. Did you know that? You don't always have to be quiet. Good morning.
Good morning.
Much better. Thank you. So, does anybody know who David was in the Bible? You recognize his name? Yep. What job did he have? He did not work at Microsoft. He was a king, and he was the most famous king of all time in Israel. And where do you say him, Stuart?
Shiny giant crown.
Yeah, a big crown. I imagine that, a giant one. So actually, today's story is about David and a giant. The giant's name was Goliath.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah, right? Okay, so how does it start?
So, basically, I know the last part.
Okay.
He takes out his slingshot and throws Sonic Goliath.
Oh, yeah,
somehow kills Goliath with one shot.
Oh, yeah, I've
spoiler alert!
Physically impossible. But that's
physically impossible to happen to die with one stone.
I don't know about the physiology of that. That's a surprisingly good children's Bible, isn't it? Yeah. So, okay, so the way it starts is that there are the Israelites. Hey, guys. There are the Israelites and then the Philistines. And the Israelites are the people that the Bible's about. And the Philistines are threatening them. And they've been fighting and fighting and fighting. And then they send out their chief strongest warrior. What was his name?
Goliath.
That's right. And Goliath says, I will beat you. Send out your strongest warrior and I will kill him and then we'll win. And they were terrified. Exactly. They were terrified. Think about the tallest person you know. Yeah, your dad might be the tallest person I know, too. The tallest and biggest person you know. Think about the tallest basketball player you've ever seen.
I don't know anybody.
Goliath? That's okay. Goliath was bigger than all of them. Some people say 9 feet tall.
Was he on stilts?
Nope. And he kept saying, send someone out to me, and I will kill them. You will lose every day. And the Israelites, the Israelites were terrified, so scared. And then David came. And David wasn't king yet. He was a little kid.
Was he a toddler?
He was not a toddler. He was old enough to sling a slingshot. But he came to the field, actually to bring his older brother's lunch. And he looked around and saw Goliath standing on the hill over there and saw all the Israelites terrified. And he said, what are y'all scared of? He's just a big guy. It's not God.
He's humble.
And they said, you're just a kid. You can't do anything about this. Go home. And he said, no. Goliath's not God. I'll fight him, and I'll win. I said, okay, well, nobody else has had any luck. So the king at the time, his name was Saul, he says, okay, well, I'll give you the best armor in the whole world. And puts, you know, big armor all over him to protect his body and a big helmet. And it's so much that David can't even walk in it. So David says, I don't need this. Take it off. I'll just be me. And then they offer him the best weapons. He says, nah, that's not my style. And he goes to a creek bed, and he picks out 5 smooth stones. Perfect stones. and he has a slingshot, and he goes out and meets Goliath. Goliath says, I'm going to kill you. And David puts a stone in his slingshot and swings it and lets it go. And it hits Goliath in the head. And he falls down.
How? It's not even sharp.
It must have hit him in just the right spot. I bet there's a medical professional out there who could explain
it.
No. And so David wins against Goliath. Now, I don't know if that happened exactly how it's told. I think something like that probably happened. I think the reason people keep telling this story, and it would have been 3,000 years ago, I think the reason people keep telling this story is because we need that encouragement. Yeah, Eliza. Maybe. I don't know. It doesn't include that detail. So people need this story, or I need this story, because I'm, hang on, Isaac, because I'm scared a lot of the time. And this story is kind of like a story about standing up to a bully or something else that scares you. Now, don't throw rocks at bullies. Let's just get that. To not be afraid. And so, so what are some things you are afraid of? Is this a serious answer? Okay. What are some things y'all are afraid of? You can whisper them if you want.
I'm afraid of snakes.
Snakes, totally. Spiders.
Nothing.
Spiders. Yeah, totally. Copperheads, smart. Have respect for animals, yes. I'm scared sometimes of being alone. Did you say fires? Spiders, yes. I can also be scared of fires, floods.
I'm also scared of the dark.
The dark, yeah. Me too sometimes, totally. I think that's very common.
I'm also scared of the dark.
So are you scared when they turn the lights out in church?
No, because we have big windows. So, I want to sing a song. Some of you will have sung this with me before, but some of you may not have. So, repeat the words after me. It's very short. Repeat the words after me, okay? Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid.
Don't be afraid.
My love is stronger than your fear.
My love is stronger than your fear.
And I have promised,
always to be near.
Yeah. All right, this is how it goes, okay? Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. My love is stronger than your fear. You want to try that part with me? Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. My love is stronger than your fear. Don't afraid. My love is stronger, and I have promised to be always near. And Alice is going to help us get back on key. Shall we try it all together?
Stronger. My love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid. My love is stronger. I
Would you pray with me and repeat after me? Dear God, who is love, thank you for loving us so that we never really have to be afraid. Amen. Thank you. Today we're starting a summer series on King David. The story of David and Goliath is a whole chapter, 50 verses, so we're going to let children's time be our scripture reading for today. David was the most beloved king in all of Israelite history. He's remembered as being beautiful and passionate, a gifted musician, an eloquent poet. He united the whole kingdom. He was in love with God. God loved him back more than a little bit. His line was going to endure forever. The promise was and is that the Messiah would even come from David's line. And I think there's bound to be some truth in all of that, even as it has expanded and been elaborated on for 3,000 years. We do have external archaeological evidence that David was a king, that he did have a dynasty, that he was mighty and amazing. But way the Bible tells the story, he was also complicated, as we all are. He could be hot-headed, rash. He gained power by being a warlord and an extortionist. He was a murderer. He assaulted women. He wasn't perfect, not by a long stretch. So this summer, we're going to tell these stories, the good, the bad, the really ugly. And we're going to look for God's grace, which runs through all of them, just like it runs through our complicated lives. But this morning is before all of that. That all still lays in the future. David is just a kid, a little kid. His brothers have gone off to war, and he's stuck at home tending the sheep, doing the kid's work. We tell it as a kid's story, and it's a fun one. There's no reason not to tell it to kids. But we shouldn't leave it behind us in children's Sunday school. This is a story that wrestles with grown-up questions, too. What are we scared of? How do we handle our fear? Goliath was terrifying to the Israelites. Every day he came out and taunted them. Every day they were paralyzed and terrorized. Then this cocky kid shows up, takes one look at the situation, and mouths off. What are y'all so scared of? Just a big guy. He's not God. But for the Israelites, the ones who'd been standing on that hill every day, listening to him taunt them, Goliath might as well have been God. He has become their all-consuming reality. Every day starts and ends with Goliath. He looms so large that he blocks out the sun. He's become their God. We all bow down to something or someone, usually more than one something or someone. And there are a number of ways to think about what it is we are bowing down to. One way that's been helpful for me is to think about what we pay attention to is what we worship. Just like our bank accounts tell us something about our real values, so too our attention, whether it's on work, success, other people, ourselves, our money, our safety, whatever it is we pay attention to, that's what we're giving power in our lives. It's what we worship. And Goliath, I think, the story of Goliath, adds another nuance to that. What we fear can also become our God. Those men out there on that hill were already, in a very real way, no longer servants of God, but servants of Goliath. They felt the way he wanted them to feel. They did what he wanted them to do. They couldn't see anything beyond him. He had become their truth, their reality. He'd become their God. What about us? What are our Goliaths? What fears loom large for us? I can think of at least three, but I'll just mention three things that are like Goliath for me, and I think for our society, and maybe for some of you too. Money. Money, or more accurately, the fear of running out, is a Goliath for me. If we believe deep down that some amount of money, usually a little more than what we currently have, will keep us safe, then we are putting our trust not in God. If we are so afraid of not having enough that we will go to any lengths to hang on to what we have, preserve what we have and get more, we're being run by our fear. That fear is Goliath up on that hill. Or how about the fear of being alone or abandoned the lengths we will go to try to avoid that fate. We often try to please everyone in our lives in some way, shape, or form. We might try to appease them. We might try to impress them. We might try to make them happy. We might preemptively push people away. If we don't give our heart away, it can't be broken, right? We might cling so tightly that the love we're looking for is squeezed out of our lives. If we can just keep everyone happy or impressed, then we'll be safe. Sounds like Goliath up there taunting us. And I think the belief that violence will save us, keep us safe, is a deep fear, Goliath, in our lives. Being safe, of course, is a basic need planted in our biology. We are not going to get beyond that this side of the grave. But being safe forever and in all ways is not something we can ultimately achieve for ourselves. None of us is getting out of this alive or unscathed. But boy, we like to imagine we could. And our first inclination is so often to try to keep ourselves safe through violence, perhaps literal, often figuratively, to meet the threat with might, to get rid of, push away, lock up, destroy whatever it is we feel like threatens us or the ones we love or the way we live our lives. Back during the second Gulf War, I went to my pastor with some moral wrestling I was going through. I was dating a Marine at the time. He'd been deployed, and I loved him, and I was horrified by the death and destruction we were doling out. I went to him with these moral conflicts. He listened and paused and said to me, "Sarah, I think Jesus would want us to get them before they get us." He didn't put any lipstick on that pig. He said it plainer than most, so plainly that I could hear how that didn't line up with my understanding of the gospel. But I think part of us, all of us, carries that inclination. We want to neutralize whatever it is that threatens us. That belief lingers in our hearts. Some part of us is so scared that we think pursuing security at any cost is worth it. Maybe it's other things that loom large for you. We've all got something that scares us deep down to our bones that looms on that hill every day. If that wasn't the case, the angels wouldn't say, "Don't be afraid," every single time they show up. It's not that there's nothing to be afraid of. The Israelites weren't delusional. Goliath was there. He was real.
He was big and he was scary. But with the moral clarity of a child, David walks up and says, well, he's not God. What are we scared of? In the end, yes, the story is about David defeating Goliath with violence. We can't make that a different ending. I think, though, whatever kernel of truth is behind this, whatever event, the story, we have to notice, is also told with the conventions of a fairy tale or morality tale. That's the structure. And so the good guys gotta get the bad guy. It just can't end any other way. And yes, it's by violence at the end. But notice, every single beat of the story, David's power is a completely different kind from Goliath's. David's small. David leans on God. When he's offered armor, he shakes it off. And he meets Goliath with his state-of-the-art weaponry, with a tool that is so simple, so old. It's almost laughable. David's response is not one that is motivated by fear. He wasn't ruled by fear. Now, none of us is going to get free of all fear on this side of the grave. In fact, to do so would be deeply unhealthy. Some measure of fear is necessary, at least in this life. We don't need to beat ourselves up about being afraid, whether it's of spiders or the dark or bad guys or loss. We do have choices about how we relate to our fear. I wonder if David needed a few breaths as he picked out those smooth stones. I wonder if when he said, Goliath is not God, if he said it as much for himself as for anyone else who was listening. The story says David wasn't afraid one bit. That's how stories go. I kind of doubt it, though. I think David's true courage was his willingness to lean into the promises of the God of life rather than let his fears dominate his life. He leaned into something eternal that could never be taken away, can never die. So what helps you with your fears that loom large, that seem to block out all the light? Maybe it's sharing your fears with a faithful friend or naming them in prayer. Maybe it's breathing, or moving, or holding someone's hand. What helps you turn your attention from Goliath to God? Maybe it's remembering a person you admire, a hero who faced their fears with grace. Maybe it's a Bible verse that comes back to you again and again. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Love casts out fear. Though I walk through the shadow, the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. The story is David wrote those words. I wonder if they came to him while he was picking up those stones, or if he wrote them years later as he remembered back to that day and was retelling himself again and again and again that fundamental truth that in life and in death, we belong to God. In life and in death, we belong to God. Say it after me. In life and in death, I belong to God. Amen. You may be seated. As we move into a time of prayer with and for one another, we'll begin with quiet. If you have prayers you'd like to have read aloud, you can pass those towards the center. There's paper in your pews to write on. You might lift up your fears in this time. Or the person on your left, the person on your right, in front of you, or behind. Come, friends, let us pray. Source of all strength, love that casts out fear. We stop for this moment and turn our hearts to you. We breathe. Remembering your spirit is in each breath. We feel our feet on the stone floor, remembering you
are the ground of being. Our backs lean on wooden pews that once were trees standing mighty and tall, reminding us of the power of being rooted in your love. We confess that we are often afraid, and we long to be less afraid, and so we turn our hearts first to praise. For the sun that rises every day and night, for the light of stars that travels through unimaginable space and time, for the miracle of soil and plants breathing and the intricate web of life, we are in awe. Let that awe cast out our fear. For the endless kindnesses that carry us through, so many we barely notice, the smile and skill of the mechanic, the dedication of the scientists, the patience of the teachers, the hands of the caregivers, the constancy of friends, we marvel. Let those marvels cast out our fear. And help us trust you with the fears that linger, the way a child tells an adult about a nightmare. Help us ask you for comfort, naturally, without shame. We are terrified by the devastation we have wrought on your earth and the consequences raining down. We are horrified by our unrelenting capacity for violence, our willingness to starve and destroy and hold captive precious, irreplaceable children of God. We are scared of failure and loss, disability and age, scarcity and loneliness and death. So we pray that you would come to us again, breathe into our hearts and through our communities your promise. Peace I give to you, peace I leave with you. I do not give as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled or afraid. Tell us again and again and again until we believe it in our very marrow. Hear us as we offer the prayers of our community.
We pray for our homeless, all serving our nation in AmeriCorps, Peace Corps, and military.
A sister-in-law recuperating from an accident.
For Rick Davis and his family as they are grieving the loss of his mother.
Norbert Kreisch also had a stroke.
And for all suffering in Ukraine, Palestine, in our nation, and around the world. And now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Friends, all that we have and all that we are is a gift from God who loves us. How richly we have been blessed. And so we offer back a portion of all we've been given out of gratitude and joy. Let us rejoice in all we've been given and all that is ours to give. Thank you.
little stories do but themselves confound. His strength the more is, no more shall stay his mind. Though he with giants fight, he will make good his right to be a pilgrim. Since, Lord, thou dost defend us with thy spirit, we know we at the end shall life inherit. Then fancies flee away, I'll hear not what men say. I'll labor night and day to be a pilgrim.
We lift these gifts. We lift our hands, our voices, our hearts, our lives. Pray that you would do with them what you will. Your work of love and healing, grace and justice in this world. We pray this trusting in your great mercy. Amen.
Thank you. be seated for just one moment. You know the saying, when the cat's away, the mice will play? Well, surprise. While Pastor Sarah was leading a team from BPC to visit our mission co-partners in the Philippines, she missed out on getting to celebrate a major ministry milestone. On May 31st, it would have been her commencement at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary, where she would have formally earned her and received her doctorate of ministry with a focus in creative writing. We couldn't let such a momentous occasion go without formal recognition. So
We could have,
but we didn't. So we have a little gift for you.
Yeah. Thank you. We just want to say how proud we are of you and all that you contribute and the love and sacrifice that you give to all of us. And this is on behalf of the congregation and the personnel committee. So I'll let Joseph take it. You have your hands full.
Now, usually the academic dean or your faculty advisor would have the honor of conferring your degree and presenting you with your hood, and we are neither of those things. But if you ask me, I think it would be more important and more meaningful to have the people who are most important to you in your life, the people who've supported you throughout this process, and the people who know how hard you've worked for this and how much it means to you to do the honors. So I guess maybe we could give Judy your stole, maybe?
Sure.
Yeah. It's okay, we'll leave that on. We'll just leave that on. And Zoe and Isaac, do you guys want to put that hat on your mom or give it to your mom? Is it silly? It's
Is it backwards?
No, I think that's right.
We'll put you on the left.
Thank you.
I think that's right.
No, it's pointy. It's
yeah,
this
that's
way.
How it goes.
We're going to pray for you too. Will you all join me in offering a blessing for our graduate? Let us pray. Holy One, all true and sound wisdom consists of two parts: the knowledge of you and of ourselves. We thank you for all the ways that Sarah has grown in grace and knowledge and understanding throughout her studies. We praise you for bringing her to this moment in her life, in the difficult moments when she felt discouraged and maybe even afraid. You gave her strength and the support of this community. In the moments of insight and clarity and renewed purpose, you rejoiced with her. In every moment, you walked alongside her, guiding her steps and directing her path. We pray that this experience will deepen and enliven her ministry among us, that we may all grow in our love and knowledge of you. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. And now it's my distinct joy to introduce the Reverend Dr. Sarah Wiles, who will offer our benediction.
Thank y'all for your support along this journey, and thank y'all for letting me be gone so much and work so much. I appreciate it. And now, I invite you to rise for the blessing. May you go with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the unending love of God, and the power of the Holy Spirit this day, unto your life eternal. Amen.